Good morning.
Good morning.
So the kiddos are going to join us in a second. So while we're waiting on the kiddos, I just want to share something with you. So the Lord said to share this morning. So recently, I've been going through some interesting stuff. We're calling it a journey. If Yolanda ever says you're going through a journey, beware, that's code word for this is going to be kind of tough. It's going to be kind of long. I'm counting the days and the weeks and the months it's been going on. It's 5, but she says I can't count. That's kind of Greek mindset. So anyway, I've been on a journey, and it's been an interesting health and spiritual journey. And I know there's a lot of you all who have gone through some difficult health journeys. And so kind of a little bit what's been going on is that I feel like I don't have a lot of strength a lot of times, like I'm weak. But I also feel like at times I can't rest, like my muscles are tense and my nerves are firing. And so this morning when I was praying and getting ready to come to church, I was just praying. I said, Lord, just give me strength. I need strength. But I also prayed at the same time. I said, but I also need rest. And sometimes we don't see rest as a place of strength. And I don't know about you guys, but this is an interesting time of year. It's really busy. As a matter of fact, yesterday I was looking at all my list of things to do. And I usually keep my list. I know I'm old fashioned. I don't keep it on my phone. But I keep them on little notepads like this. Well, yesterday I actually had to get out the big notepad. The yellow one. It wouldn't fit on that. And I like yellow. You know, I was reminded this morning, I was thinking about this, and I remember I was a school counselor for almost 25 years. And at my last school, I was there for 17 years, and I used yellow notepads of all different sizes. And one day I went in the supply room, and all that was there was white notepads. And I went out to the secretary, and I said, what's going on? What's up with this? And she said, well, like, I can't get yellow right now. They're out of yellow. I said, I can't work here anymore. Kelly, this is a true story. So you know what they did? They went through the school and they found all the yellow notepads. Lori did. Lori Kelly. And she brought me all the yellow notepads so I could work there. And I still like yellow. We like yellow, don't we, Gary? We like yellow. But this is a busy time of year. We have a lot of lists and a lot of things to do. But when I was praying this morning for strength, I said, Lord, I need strength. I need to be strong. I need to be able to stand. I need to be able to do the things you want me to do. But I also need to be able to rest, and my body isn't letting me rest. And this is what the Lord said. He said, there's strength in the rest. So I don't have to have either or. I don't have to have this, just the strength. I don't have to muster up the strength. And just resting doesn't always mean just laying on the couch. Because you can lay on the couch, but if your body's not resting, you're not truly recuperating and resting. So both of those things are so important in the season. So someone needs to hear that this morning, that there is strength in rest. And my prayer for this house is that we will find the fullness that God has in both of those things, in the strength and in the rest. So would you stand and worship with us this morning?
Oh, strong. If you have a prayer language and you feel like just releasing that, I feel like it's going to be just a special offering to Jesus for us to just give full voice to our spirits right now. So let's just join in the angel song and
I love you, Lord Jesus. Yeah.
we sing out the name Emmanuel right now?
Oh, no, 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 no,
Paper. I have had a lot of healing and deliverance from a lot of people in this body, so I'm over my OCD stuff, so I can handle white paper now. I absolutely have to. I like yellow, but I can handle white. So
all right, we're going to bless the children. They follow Miss Desiree out. Yay. We're going to pray for Miss Desiree and for Rachel today. They have a lot going on. I want to thank you all for being here today. I know that sometimes you have lots of other things you'd like to do, like sleep. But I just want you to know, I literally send an angel to wake you up and say, hey. Give them a good day, wake them up, make them excited to be here.
Amen. Amen.
And sometimes the angel has to circle around to come to me again. So just so you all know. I'm excited because Lori was creating for us and Gail a wonderful Christmas party on Friday night. Yeah. Can we just give a round of thank you? Yeah. It was a beautiful, beautiful time, and I just thank you guys for all your work. I know there was a lot of hard work going into it. It made it look easy for doing. I also want us to remember that we are in the middle of Hanukkah. Hanukkah is that season of lights and season of bringing revelation and bringing the Word of God to us again in a fresher way. So I encourage you to read the blessings. Joey sent home little Hanukkah boxes with all our children Friday night, and she knows better than to not send one home with me. So I have my little Hanukkah box, okay, and every day I get so excited about opening up what's the gift she's going to do, and I read the blessings, and I read all those things. So if you didn't get a Hanukkah box because you're a grown-up, adopt a child, and you can get your own Hanukkah box. But it just helps us to put into focus what are we praying for and what's the gift God's giving to us and where we are. I also wanted to, Lori was giving me a hard time this morning, y'all. I know you can't imagine. But she was saying, you're doing less and less. I go, I know. I know. You see, if you train up leaders, the whole point is you do less and less and they do more and more. So I want to just say to all the leaders and all the people that help so much, thank you. Because for some of the first times in my life, I can see the fruits of everything he said, if you will stay steady, I will give you. And so it's a wonderful thing to have the body of Christ take their place and to do that. So I just want to thank everybody that's taking their place, doing the hard work. Some of you scream and holler, but that's okay. We're going to be there, right? I want to take a few minutes this morning to invite Sheila to come up. Sheila has heard Holy Spirit, and she has voluntold, because he told her. I didn't even tell her this time. Okay, I kind of semi-confirmed it, but I didn't tell her, okay. But she has been encouraged by Holy Spirit to put her mouth and her actions where God wants them to be. And I'll just let her share with you what's going to happen, and just give a brief testimony of where she's going. Come on, share with us.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I know this is not the first time I've stood up here, but this time it's a little bit more nervous than the last couple of times. But first of all, I just want to say hello. And I thank you all for being my brothers and sisters in Christ. And most of you all know my name. I'm Sheila Means. But right now, it's very important that people know my name, Sheila Means. I'm running for the Stillwater School Board, Ward 4. Yes. this race is what they call a nonpartisan race, meaning you don't declare what political persuasion you are. And I think that's the way it should be, because what happened with our children should matter to each and every one of us, regardless of our political persuasion. But in order for me to complete this assignment, it is critical that I have each and one of your help. And I'm going to do something a little bit different than what you usually see when a politician stands in front of you, because I'm not a politician. I'm just someone who wants to help my community. So I'm going to tell you what I need first, and then I'll tell you a little bit about the position and a little bit about me. The first thing I'm going to need is your vote. I'm going to need your vote on April 2nd, or if you want to vote early, it'll be March 28th or 29th. Second, I'm going to need you to tell your friends, your family, your coworkers, church members, neighbors to vote for me. Third, please share my social media posts and invite the people that you know to go and look at my posts and ask them to share it. You know, it's one of those things where you start with one, and then that one share, and you got three, and that three share, now you got nine, and you just keep building. That way my name get out there and the message that I'm telling it gets out there. My post, my Facebook page is Sheila Means for Stillwater School Board, Ward 4. Fourth, I'm gonna ask you to consider having a meet and greet for me. That just requires you to get a couple of your friends together, 5, 10, 15, those of you who know everybody, maybe 100. And just introduce me to them and let me tell them what I'm running for and who I am. And fifth, I do need money to help get my name and the message out into the school, Stillwater School District. And this money will be used to purchase push cars, yard signs, car magnets, and also to help pay a consultant that helped you to know how to step through the political process. Yeah. So the Stillwater School Board is opportunity, is a volunteer opportunity. There's no pay for being a school board member. It's all intangible. The members are elected for 5 years, and we have 2 meetings a month. And both of those meetings happen on the same day. They have a special meeting and a regular meeting. The special meeting is where the board members come together and do the business of the board. The regular meeting is a meeting where the general public is invited to come in. And during that meeting, the board recognizes student achievements, teacher and staff achievements, and they celebrate the successes of the district. But it's also a time where members of the public, the community, they can come in and they can speak to the board and address any issues or concerns they have or any happenings that are going on in the district. Each board member must complete specific training within 15 months of being installed in the position. The board writes policies that governs the district. The board only has one employee, and that is the superintendent. The board hires the superintendent, and then the superintendent has the responsibility to implement the policies for the good of the students, the parents, the teachers, and the staff in the district. The board also approves the budget. And you can see my Facebook page again, Sheila Means for Stillwater School Board, Ward 4, and you can learn about all of the duties and responsibilities of the board. Because if you don't know what somebody is responsible for doing, there's no way you can hold them accountable for doing it.
Amen.
So I put that information out there so all of you all can know. I get this position when I get this position.
Amen.
That's right.
You all determine when I get this position. Then you'll know what you need to be holding me responsible for. So who am I? Again, I'm Sheila Means. I've been involved in the Stillwater community since 2012. I'm married to Dr. Aaron Means for 23 years. We have 5 adult children in our blended family, and we have 7 grandchildren. So you can see one of the reasons I'm very passionate about what's going on in the education system. I don't have any children in the education system in Stillwater Public School District, but what is allowed to happen in one part of the United States, it can quickly and easily metastasize to another part. So if we can make some good things happen in the Stillwater School District, then we can see those good things metastasizing across our nation.
Amen.
So let it start here in Stillwater. So Aaron and I met while we were serving in the United States Air Force. I'm a retired United States Air Force major, serving 21 years and 4 days. I don't know how they got all that time in 4 days. I'm a dual master prepared advanced practice nurse, a retired nurse midwife. I delivered over 500 babies, and a women health nurse practitioner. I was the visionary, the founder, and the CEO of Karen Hinn Healthcare Center. That's a federal qualified health center located in McAllister, Pittsburgh County, Oklahoma. And that center is still functioning today and have expanded and serving all of Pittsburgh County and the surrounding area. And a federal qualified health center is a center where people can go to get health care, medical care, regardless of their ability to pay. And that was another thing that God put on my heart. It wasn't something that I ever dreamed that I would be doing, but he put it on my heart to do, and he had me to collect certain people around me, and we got it done, and like I say, it's still functioning and expanded. I currently serve on the board of Shallows Place. It's a maternity and parenting home here in Stillwater, and Shallows Place provides a place to belong for young women, 18 to 23, who have an unplanned pregnancy and does not have a support system. And you can check out Shallows on Facebook, and their web page is shallowsplaceincorporated.org. I'm a chaplain at the Stillwater Police Department and a co-organizer of the Stillwater National Day of Prayer and Veterans Day event once a year here in Stillwater. And most of you already know this, I'm a child of God. I love my family, my country, and my community. And our children and our grandchildren are our future. And I'm motivated by my faith into being a part of ensuring that they receive an authentic education, because their education will aid them in securing a prosperous present and future, mm-hmm. and that they may perpetuate to their children or to the next generation. So I'm running on a campaign to bring common sense policies and practice to our school board. As a board member, I will focus on student safety, academics, arts, sports, promote parental rights and involvement for complete transparency, and support teachers and staff, empowering them to focus on education and materials only. Again, I'm Sheila Means. I'm running for Stillwater School Board, Ward 4. If you live in the school district, which you can find out if you're not sure by going to Oklahoma Voter Portal, and I'm asking for your vote, and I'm asking you to tell others about me. So come join Team Sheila Means.
Amen. Okay, now one of our warriors has decided to step up, so our job is to pray. Amen. So would you reach your hands towards Sheila? Because this is a step. This is a big step. And who she's coming up against is a beloved of the community. Okay. And they don't see all the stuff that's going on. And so God has chosen this warrior to do that. So Father God, we just come together in the name of Jesus. And we thank you for choosing this servant of yours to step into a place where she will be everything you are asking her to be. Yes. That she will represent your light, yes. that she will bring that light into the darkness. But Father, I ask that you just supernaturally surround her with your love. Yes. And that your love so permeates from her that even when she's saying things that they don't want to hear, your love will transcend that, and they will be able to hear what Father God says. So every born-again person in this school district, I hereby awaken your spirit, and I say in the name of Jesus, we bind, muzzle, and gag all the things that would stop you from hearing the truth.
Yes.
And Father, we say it is time to take a stand, and we recognize that you've chosen this one. So we all say right now, we put our victories, our authorities, our anointings, and we come into agreement with Sheila that she will be able to accomplish it. And we all say, Father, wake us up. Do whatever you need to do to surround her in prayer and in authority so she can do what she's called to do. And we thank you, Father, for choosing her. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
It. It's just one less thing I have to do. You guys, you get this. Arista, yes.
If we're going to give to Sheila, is there a specific way we need to do that for the campaign?
Yes, but Yeah. Why don't you talk to her afterwards, okay, and we'll make it clear, and we'll put the things on the back table. So people, do you have your cards with you today so you can put, okay. She'll put some cards out there so you can contact her and do that.
And so if you live in Stillwater, can you vote for her, or do you have to be in a certain district?
Nope. Anybody who's
anybody
in Stillwater.
Including
outside. You don't have to be in city Stillwater.
You just have to be Stillwater school.
Stillwater, if your kids would go to Stillwater school.
You pay taxes.
You pay taxes. That's what it is.
And your address is in Stillwater school.
Yeah.
Well, our address is not. We own property over here, but we...
If you own property, that's a different thing, so
okay,
you can talk to... Okay, I want to arrest it. I want everybody to understand what a huge thing this is that I make her get up here.
Makes me?
Uh-huh. For years I made her, and then you know what happened?
She created
it. And now it's just huge. I literally was texting this morning another pastor here in Oklahoma, and they were saying, well, I know you're preparing to go. No, actually I'm not today, because Arista has now done first fruits every month for me.
She's got it. She's got it.
Yeah,
7 years
since we started on Sunday morning.
It's been,
how many?
Yeah.
1 year doing Sunday morning.
1 year doing Sunday morning.
Yeah.
So we bless you. We thank you.
Thank you for listening.
Give us to that.
You know, is that on, Kevin? Thank God for Kevin.
Yes.
Amen.
And our worship team. Wow.
Yes.
No? I'm so thankful he lets me not hold a microphone. I always got in trouble anyway. I never held it in the right place. I don't have very many clothes in this color scheme. Just wanted to throw that out there. These pants are going to the donation pile when this is over. Okay. It's right. I need to increase my jewel tones just for first fruits. I love seeing all the blue. I really enjoy blue as a Christmas color instead of the traditional green and blue. All right, everyone say Tibet.
Tibet.
I remodeled these slides. The old ones were ugly. You can thank me. They're still not quite. I get like a kind of a vision. PowerPoint, and I need to have I need some more creative people on that team, I think. But that's okay. We'll go from here. All right. Originally, this lesson last year was named Light, the light of my eyes. You'll understand why what eyes has to do with this month here in a minute. As I was praying and studying, it came clear to me that this year, our focus is testimony. And I think you're going to see that as we unwind the lesson. So just kind of have that in the back of your brain and be thinking about the word testimony and how we can apply it to the season. I thought it was very fitting that we sang, "Go Tell It on the Mountain." I was like, yes, I love it when we're all in alignment. It's a beautiful thing. Okay, so Tibet. 5784. Now, this is my sixth time to go through the calendar cycle teaching first fruits. We started teaching on a Sunday night, did some Wednesday mornings, and eventually landed on Sunday morning. So I still get nervous. You would think by now I'd be like, I got this, right? It takes me a while to settle down. Okay, so I'm going to read this prayer over you. This will be part of my settling down. May you give us long life and a life of peace, a life of goodness, a life of blessing, a life of sustenance, a life of physical health, a life in which there is a fear of heaven and a fear of sin, and life in which there is no humiliation, a life of wealth and honor, a life in which we will have love of Torah and awe and reverence of God, a life in which Adonai the Lord fulfills our heartfelt request for good. Everyone say good.
Good.
Amen. Salah. Okay, Tibet means good. So how fitting for our month of light that it means good. Everybody want to have a good month?
Yes.
So we're here to celebrate, and what a wonderful season of celebration. You know, we start with Hanukkah and get to move right into our cultural holiday of Christmas. And Yolanda's done a great job of digging out the science and the calendars and showing us that we believe Jesus was conceived on the 25th of Kislev, which is the beginning of Hanukkah. And then we move into, in the
that particular year was also December 25th for his conception. So we can have faith and joy in the fact that our season is all about Jesus, and we get to continue to celebrate him from Hanukkah all the way through to the new year. Amen?
Amen.
Okay, the calendar. Today is actually the 27th of Kislev. And as I've already alluded, Hanukkah is always on the 25th of Kislev when the Maccabees retook the temple in Jerusalem from the Amalekites. They have so many names for that little group. From the evildoers, let's call them that. So tonight you would be on your fourth candle. So you use your helper candle and go 1, 2, 3, 4 would be this evening for the Hanukkah lights, the festival. The Rosh Kodesh, which is what we're here to celebrate today, which is absolutely another celebration, celebrating Jesus and all that God has done through our calendar, is actually on Wednesday this week in the evening, just so you know when it transitions. And we are going to continue to do Hanukkah all the way into a couple days into Tibet. So it is one of the only holidays that bridges 2 months. Cool. And it's a cycle of 8 days. So this is something that if God speaks to you, and this is always my prayer, he's going to tell you things in this lesson that are different than when he tells Eden or than when he tells me, even from what he's going to tell Yolanda. So find your thing. Find your thing and hold on to it and let it guide your month into a month of blessing. So one of the things that spoke to me was this 8 days cycle. And God showed me that when something in my life maybe doesn't go as planned or is against my own little rules, I have a lot of rules, the sooner I turn that over to the Lord, the quicker I put it on his throne, on the mercy seat, that there is an 8 day cycle of blessing for that to be turned around. So instead of letting it last 8 weeks or 8 years, I'm going to choose 8 days. And I'm going to have faith in God that we're going to work that out together. And I'm going to trust in his purpose, even in the pain, even in the hurt, but also in my blessings. Amen?
Amen.
So this is a season to evaluate our blessings and make sure we're maturing and growing in the Lord. Okay. All right, tonight we're going to look at all the elements that we look at every month. So God in his wisdom is a God of order. He's a God that gave us a calendar that is based on the lunar cycle, which just should not be a shock to anyone. Anyone that's in farming or hunting or even a woman's cycle are based on what? The lunar calendar. So this is the calendar that God gave us. Satan wants nothing more than for us to be out of alignment. And this month is a month of alignment, and so there's a double portion there. So every month we look at the 12 tribes, the 12 months, the history of those months, the 12 gemstones, you know, the 12 constellations. There's, you know, God in his order gave us the 12 disciples. So 12 is a number, and we look every month at those prophetic things to see what God is saying to us over the month. And just like I said, I've been doing this for 6 years, and I'm always in shock and awe on how, why some foundational truths are the same for Tibet. It's always Hanukkah in Tibet. It's always the month of the Ark of the Covenant. It's a 10. Some things are foundationally true, but God has a prophetic, moving, living word that is going to come through in this year of the door. We're in the year 5784 on the Hebrew calendar. So if you're new to this, don't let it overwhelm you, but start to see some patterns and pick a few pieces to learn from, and you get to gain in that learning and that wisdom every year as you go up your glory mountain. Amen. Okay, so today we're going to look at the history and events surrounded on the month of Tibet. We're going to look at the tribe of Dan, which is very complicated. We're going to look at the alphabet letter IN, and this is going to talk about our eyes. And we're going to look at the constellation Capricorn, and we're going to know that we can enjoy all the turquoise and blue. I love seeing all the, even little Asher had on a blue shirt. Was that on purpose today? No, see? Just Holy Spirit doing his thing. Okay. All right, I picked blue doors for our slides. That was kind of fun. Give me a little focus there. It's the year of the door. So we're here to walk through some doors. Amen.
Amen.
In every Rosh Kodesh, I hope that you would come with the expectation of God revealing which doors you need to go through and which doors you need to close. So it's very much a spiritual prophetic of I want to move in alignment with the Lord and do away with all the evildoers. So I need to shut this door. I need to open this door. So if you've been praying along those lines, let's see what God has to say. Okay, oh, did we skip? There we go. All right, as I've already said, we have a few more days here in Hanukkah. Some of the other names that you will hear for Hanukkah are the Feast of Dedication. Does anyone have a Hebrew Bible? that's all they call it in there, is the Feast of Dedication. And it's actually mentioned a few times in the chapter of John, and it's called the Feast of Light, the Feast of Miracles, because of the miracle of the oil and the lamp staying lit for the 8 days when they only had oil for one day, and the temple was rededicated to the Lord from the Maccabees. And this is before Jesus Christ was born. So when you go to John chapter 10 and read verses 25 through 39, when Jesus is walking in that very temple on Hanukkah, we can then draw those beautiful prophetic fulfillment that Christ is the light of the world. He is the miracle and the light that continues to shine and continues to burn. And he's walking through the temple in Solomon's colonnade, they call it, on Hanukkah, and teaches a message about how they haven't been listening, because they ask him again, are you the Messiah? He says, you've not been listening. I have said it plainly. Yes, I am the Messiah. I am the light of the world. So in this celebration, we get to celebrate Jesus on a whole nother level, to where our testimony builds, where we want to talk about this light and how it impacts our life. Amen. This is Tibet. Isn't that beautiful? So I would encourage you to read that in your Bible studies this month. So these two scriptures just kept coming up over and over and over again as I was writing this lesson. So I thought it was worthy just to read them over you, and you're welcome to write them down and study them throughout your month. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. Everyone say light.
Life.
The light shines in the darkness, and this is my favorite part. The darkness has not overcome it.
Amen.
So whatever tribulation or trial or disappointment that you have in your life cannot squish the light of Christ.
Amen.
So when you don't know where to go, you go sit in your place, in your covenant place with Christ, and let that eight-day cycle begin. Amen?
Amen.
Okay, your lamp, your word is a lamp for my feet and a light on my path. Now, 5784, one of the prophetic words for the word dalet, for the Hebrew letter, is pathway. So here we are in a season of light. We have the pathway of Christ and God and the kingdom, and his ways are the best ways.
Amen.
Amen. So let that light shine on your path. And when you don't feel God, you know, we especially as Holy Spirit believers, right? We want to feel things. We want to be moved and have these experiences where we know without a shadow of doubt it's God, right? Well, it doesn't always happen that way, does it? We need to remember that we go back to his word, and that is our foundational truth. And as that bubbles up in the inside of us, that light then begins to shine, and that revelation then begins to come, and then hopefully the emotions come. But if they do not, Christ is still who he says he is.
Amen.
So this is the two scriptures I felt like were the focus for this month. Okay, Tevet means good. The word Tav, you can look that up as a Hebrew letter. We talk about the Hebrew letters a lot because there are so much prophetic value to every Hebrew letter. But it means good, and we are beginning the winter months. So we've moved up to the northern side of the camp. That, you know, everything is in threes when we talk about the tribes and the seasons. So here we are celebrating a new season. And we are going to know that Dan, which is the entire camp, gets a name, right? We got the camp of Judah, camp of Reuben, the camp of Benjamin, and now we're in the camp of Dan for the next 3 months. And Dan means to grow, to judge, and to mature. Everyone say mature.
Mature.
So when we get together every month, we should be maturing. We should be growing. This is a part of a victorious life cycle, is that you should be changing and growing. So a profitable question to ask yourself this month is, how have I matured since last Tevet?
Amen.
Amen. So if you're a journaler like I am, I like to look back. I have one of those journals that has the 5 years, so I can see for 5 years, you know, at the same day of the month. I love it. Because I can look back and say, okay, I see victory here, I see a shift here, I see I need to pray here, and we continue to grow and evolve. You can't escape it. The world is going to grow and evolve around you. Now, you can get on board and do it victoriously, or you can sit back and let it take you where it wants to take you. I choose to be on the offense, not defense. Amen?
Amen.
So this is Tevet. This is the time, and how fitting that it is the beginning of our year on the Greek calendar, right? All these resolutions, all of these what's your focus for the new year? Well, I say God asks us to do this weekly, monthly, and at our feasts, because he's the ultimate life coach, right? We don't need to wait for New Year's Eve to start a new resolution. We can start right now. We can start with Tevet, looking at last Tevet and moving forward. Okay, this is a month to fast and purify the liver. So have you ever noticed a lot of people do what, a Daniel fast in January? I love it when I think all pastors get inspired by Holy Spirit, whether they know it or not.
Yeah.
And I don't know how many times I have turned on a sermon from Joyce Meyer, Joel Osteen, Craig Groeschel, Yolanda McCune, and they're all saying the same thing. Now, I know Yolanda's hearing from Holy Spirit, and she knows that's where she's hearing it from. I'm not so sure the others have any idea. However, God is still God, and things are still moving. So therefore, guess what? It's time to fast. After all your holiday goodies, it's also very healthy for your body to have a reset. You can ask some of these nurses in here how good a fast is for you, not just spiritually, but as well as physically. We're going to talk about that more when we get to the constellation and see how this is another thing I absolutely love about this calendar and these elements. They layer and they flow. And the more I do it, the more of the flow I see. So this is going to flow us right into a secular new year, and God is still lining up because he's God.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen?
Okay. The 10th of Tevet is actually a minor fast that has been in the community of the Israelites for a long time, from the time that Nebuchadnezzar started his siege on Jerusalem. They do a three-day fast on the 10th of Tevet to commemorate that. So if that's something that speaks to you, that you want to do, there you have it, 10th of Tevet. Okay, discipline is very much a part of maturity. Everyone say, ugh. I'm a very disciplined person, but it's very much just the personality God gave me. It's a gift. I understand that. But I will say, discipline is never pleasant in the beginning. But when you learn to mature with discipline and you learn the fruit of that exercise, it is a beautiful thing. And the scriptures are constantly encouraging us to be disciplined. So this matches with Tevet and our maturity. Okay. All right, this is the 10th month. Now, 10 has all kinds of meanings that we could unpack. But the one that I hear reverberating the most at this 10 means godly authority. So this is the month to be praying for your leaders. And you need to be checking, who are you aligned underneath? I feel very, very confident in my alignment under Yolanda.
Amen.
But I also need to be praying about my alignment under my husband.
Mm-hmm.
Right? You're welcome. Okay. And I need to be praying for my state leaders, my school board members. Yeah. I need to be praying for my nation and my commander-in-chief, whether I like him or not. I tend to pray for those that are pulling his puppet strings.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. Little slide right there. Okay, did you catch it? Yeah, okay. 10th is a lot of blessing that comes with the number 10. The tithe is a blessing that God gives back to you. He doesn't say tithe because I need your 10%. He says tithe so I can protect you and bless you. That is with the number 10. 10 is also means mercy, the hand of God. It's nod, so it's yod. I always want to say yod, but it's yod. Yod is a picture of your hand lifted to God and receiving his mercy.
Amen.
The Ark of the Covenant held the Ten Commandments. The Ark of the Covenant is also called the Ark of Testimony. And what's on top of that is the mercy seat. Part of the Hanukkah message is that in destruction, God still showed mercy. We've got the mercy seat. We've got the mercy of Hanukkah. We need to be reaching up in this 10th month and allowing the mercy of God to strengthen you. We get, I don't know how many of you are hard on yourself, but I know several of you in this room that are entirely too hard on yourself. We want to fix things instead of allowing God to fix them. Get your hands in the air, get on that mercy seat, and allow Him to flow through you this month. And in return, that light that's going to shine through you is going to impact everyone around you. This is 10. This leads me to testimony, the art of my testimony. So what do I mean by testimony in Tibet? I could get up here and tell you that I have overcome childhood abuse. I have overcome rampant divorce in my family. We have closed generational curses on early death, adultery, addiction, anxiety. I could list them and give you my testimony. That's not what this is about. This is not about me. This is about the light of Christ and the work He did on the cross. That is the testimony of Hanukkah and the testimony of Christmas, that that light has changed my life and it can change your life. Yes. That is the testimony we're after. And this gold cherubim and this mercy seat, you know, when God gave instructions to build this in Exodus, you should read it. He started from the inside of that chest and worked His way out. We have to start on the inside of us and have that faith of testimony of Christ and His work, and then let that shine in our light out to the world. This is testimony. I can make it all about me and all that I've done, right? I haven't done anything except allow Christ to love on me, to accept His mercy, and then strengthen me to change. Amen. 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 All right, this segues beautifully into the alphabet of this month, which is IN. Everyone say IN. More doors. Do you see number 3? It gets better. Wait, as the doors come. Okay, you'll see. Okay. Those aren't blue, but whatever. Okay. IN is 10 sevens. Everyone say 10 sevens.
10 sevens.
It's the 16th letter, and it represents the number 70. But it is a pictograph of two eyes, and it means to see. Well, we're in the light of Hanukkah, in the light of Christ. The revelations of Christ is how we see, hopefully, right? We want to be seeing with our good eye and not our evil eye. And I don't mean right, left. If you're lefty, you can go this way. I don't care. But do you understand the symbolism here, the prophetic word, and how fitting for it to be in Tibet? That this is the light of the world has come into conception and then walked the tabernacle and is and blessing us with Holy Spirit in this season. And here we are to see. God says, make sure you're using your spiritual eyes and not the cultural, worldly eyes. Two eyes connect to the brain by an optic nerve. You have a choice, is what this is saying. And I can give a ton of examples. I will use the conflict in Israel because that's going to come up again here when we get to the constellation. You can choose to look at that as, oh my, you know, just with so much stress and distress and see the evil and the inhumanitarian things that are going on. And just, you, it makes you want to agree with the media that it needs just needs to stop. We need a ceasefire. We need peace. We need. But if you choose to look at it through God's eye, through your spiritual eye, you're going to see the opportunity of Christ to change that nation for good.
Yes,
we're going to get rid of the evil, and we're going to pray that the leaders of Israel learn to rely on God and His revelation to impact that nation, and we're going to see an opportunity there, and it's going to change the direction of our warfare. So you need to be looking at every situation, big and small, with your spiritual eye and not your negative. There's a negative report every time, but there is also, this is where the lamp, your word is a lamp to my feet. We have those foundational truths in us to know and know how to discern when we see evil. You know how they know when it's a counterfeit dollar bill? They study the correct dollar bill, and then that highlights to them when something is off. They don't study all the different, you know, ways people cheat. They study what is right, and then they know when it's wrong. This is what I and the Tibet is about. As we go through this month, I promise you there's going to come a situation. You're going to say, oh, Arista said. Look with my, what is the positive? We have to focus. Everyone say focus. Because Satan wants nothing more to derail you during this season. Because you can't have a testimony if you're all mixed up in your junk. Amen. Okay. When we choose to use the evil eye or agree with an evil structure, this opens a door. Everyone say door. To sin. We give sin an opening. No thanks. I say no thanks. Okay. A person is said to be a miniature world, and the eye reflects the world outside to reveal what's inside. Remember I talked about building the ark from the inside out. Same thing here. Your eyes are that gateway to see what's going on inside and is coming outside. A person's outlook reveals their inner character. Are you a positive? Are you a faith-speaking, victorious child of God? Or are you negative Nelly? Tough, huh? And some of us are more predisposition one way or the other. But God calls us to focus. Amen. Okay. I love this. Okay, now, interesting enough, this scripture, you look at the different translations, and some translations are very pointed that it is talking about money. Other translations are making it more broad. I would say that money is definitely a contender for our attention, correct? It maybe makes us fudge a little on our principles or our morals. So you definitely could put money, but I think you could put anything in here that distracts you from God's purposes. The eyes is the lamp of the body. So if your eye is clear, you're receiving things spiritually, your whole body will be full of light, benefiting from God's precepts. But if your eye is bad, if you are spiritually blind, and this is what makes us cry and pray for our non-believer friends that we love, right? And our family members. So they're just missing out on some mercy and love and joy. But if your eye is bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. So if the very light inside you, your inner self, your heart, your conscience is dark, how great and terrible is that darkness? I've had this explained to me that this is what hell is actually like. It's just the void of God. No one can serve two masters, either will hate one or love the other, will be voted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. Now, this the Amplified Bible, this is a translation I chose, says money, possessions, fame, status, whatever you value more than Lord. So, this month is a month of celebration. This is a month of light. This is a month of testifying all the good things that Christ has done. But this is also a month to focus. To pay attention to how you perceive things and how you digest those things. And we're going to be more mature as we grow. Amen? Okay. Tribe of Dan. This is where it gets fun. I actually spent a lot of time. Dusty made me a 3-mile trail at our place. So I just walk and walk and walk. Anyway, I put in my headphones and I listened to every YouTube I could find on the Tribe of Dan. Like, what is going on? Right? So I'll tell you what I found. Okay, we have moved to the north camp. Do you see how we have, now everyone's like, why are we always at this camp at Mount Sinai? Like we never leave, right? But actually, when God gave this to Moses and aligned these tribes in this most beautiful order, there was so much for us to learn and glean from here. This is a covenant school that we could spend a lot of time digesting. So this order was specifically laid out by God, and this order shows that each of us belong in one of these tribes, and each of us has a piece to the puzzle. And each of these has a prophetic meaning. It's full of revelation, but it's also full of pitfalls for us to learn from. So we're going to learn some of those today. So we are actually focused on Dan in the grouping of Dan, and they are called the rear guard. So when these tribes march out for war or march out to change locations, they start with Judah in the east, and they start marching in this order, and these three are in the rear. This is the rear guard. And the pieces of the tabernacle are sprinkled in between and protected. So as an ecclesia here with our leadership team, if we were to march somewhere, Yolanda would line us. She'd line us up and we would have a rear guard, which our rear guard, these weren't the fighters. These were your artists, your bakers, your metal workers, your songwriters, your dancers. So why are they in the rear? Do you feel like you're really well protected on the backside? No. You know why? Because God is our rear guard. This is the expression and beauty of God in these three tribes. This is the tangible expression of what we get to feel and touch and see in the earth realm that these creative people bring to our lives. And God says, let me show off and I will be your rear guard. So if you are someone who brings song, piano, guitar, or you bring music or art, you are the beautiful expression of all things that God wants humans to see. How beautiful is that? And then our rear guard is very strong because it is the glory of the Lord. So how beautiful that we're in this season of light, this season of beauty in the winter months. Isn't that interesting? I asked God that. Why in the winter? Because, you know, sometimes I think of winter as dark and cold. But really, when the sun shines in the mountains in the winter on the snow, it is one of the most beautiful scenes that you can ever envision. And it's a time where we get more rest, just as Lori was talking about, there's strength in rest. So in the winter months, we have more time and rest to enjoy the beauty of the Lord. I thought that was cool. Okay. All right, so we're going to be unpacking these the next 3 months with Dan, Asher, and Naphtali, the skilled craftsmen, the gardeners, and our dancers, our writers. It's going to be great. Rear guard. Now, let me talk about rear guard for a minute. Who's read this book, Spiritual Warfare? Chuck Pierce.
I haven't.
There's a 32-day Bible study. There's a 32-day Bible study in the back of here of how to establish your rear guard. And I have been praying this fervently in my house. I've been doing my Jericho March. That's one of the things in the 32 days, is to do your Jericho March around your property. And I'm seeing, it's been bumpy. But I'm seeing the fruit of those prayers. I'm seeing us being delivered on another level. And I'm as shocked as you are. But it's been good, bumpy but good. I have a lot of faith in it. I have a faith that we're ending some cycles. Amen? So I would encourage you to learn about that rear guard. And basically it says, just like we learn on this calendar, I'm done with that and I'm moving on. And now I have this, my next thing. And instead of being like, oh my God, there's one more thing. That's the evil eye speaking, by the way. The good eye says, yes, we're on to the next thing. We're maturing, we're growing, and God has us on this beautiful journey. And if we can embrace that, how much less painful is this process? Amen. Okay. All right, Isaiah 58. Then your light shall break forth. Everyone say light.
Light.
Like the morning. Your healing, who needs healing? Shall spring forth speedily, and your righteousness shall go before you, and the glory of the Lord will be behind you. So praise and worship with Judah goes before me and sets the atmosphere, and then the glory of the Lord is behind me. So I feel very cozy in my middle spot. All right. All right, Dan was the fifth son of Jacob. Now listen to this prophecy that Jacob spoke over him. Now when Jacob was dying, he said, I have a blessing for each of the 12 tribes, each of his sons. And Dinah, I'm not sure what was going on there. Anyway, on the future of Dan, Dan will judge his people as one of Israel's tribes. So we see that word judge here again. Dan will be a snake on the path, a viper on the road, that snaps at the heels of horses, causing their riders to fall off. Okay, I don't want to be a snake. Do you want to be a snake?
Yeah.
But I was listening to some commentary on this, and this is the interpretation I love the most. Dan won his victories without having to touch his enemy. Do you see that? What did he do? He scared the horses. They fell off. He won. Something to think about. Our rear guard does not have to be in a physical entanglement. There can be victory and winning. And this was, Dan was supposed to be a judge. He was supposed to be able to tell you, this is the good eye, this is the evil eye. He was supposed to be a judge and supposed to be one that was taught the Israelites how to grow and mature and how to win victories without getting physically entangled. Cool, huh? Okay, but what happened? Where did Dan go? Now, a lot of us know, and we talk about where the lost tribe of Dan. Everybody heard that before? In Revelation 7, when we go to the what I call Earth 3.0, to Jerusalem's temple, they list the 12 tribes. You know, the 144,000 that get sealed. They're supposed to be virgins and righteous, and there's members from each tribe, and the tribes are listed. And Dan is not on that list of the 12 tribes, so everyone's freaking out. What happened to Dan? Why is he not on this list? Well, it's not ever really told explicitly in the scriptures, but there's a lot of theories. So I'm just going to tell you the theories. You can pray about it and see what you think. Dan's tribe was one of the, Dan and Ephraim were the first to fall into idolatry after, you know, after David's, when the, Jeroboam starts with the idols, right? And, you know, the southern and northern kingdom of Israel split. They fall into idolatry, and Dan and Ephraim are the leading territories in that idolatry. Ephraim's name's not on the list either, by the way. And no one ever says, where's Ephraim? Why is he not on the list? Well, if you know the 12 tribes, Joseph got a double portion, and it went to his two sons, Manasseh and Ephraim. So when you look at the 12 tribes on Revelation 7's list, Levi is back listed, and Manasseh is listed, and Joseph is listed. So it's assumed that Joseph means Ephraim. Get it? It's his father. But why is it not Joseph is Ephraim and Manasseh, and Dan is on, it makes sense why Levi's on the list in my mind. We go back to Joseph, and everything's back in its right order, and Dan would be on the list. Some believe that the idolatry kicked him and Ephraim off the list. That God, because God told them. That is the one thing he will not tolerate. He was very clear. Others believe that Dan was absorbed by the tribe of Levi, and that represents Dan. Like the tribes, all the tribes were sinful. All the tribes fell into idolatry one way or another. All the tribes fell off their redemptive path. So why would Dan be punished and not the others? So that's another line of thinking, is that he's very much there. It's just listed either with Manasseh or with Levi, and Ephraim is listed with Joseph. It's just a lost in a translation kind of thing. So what do I choose to believe? I choose to believe I don't want to fall into idolatry. I don't want to be off the list. You know, whether I'm absorbed by another tribe or if I get extinguished, whatever it is, I'm going, that's what I would learn from that. So I want to look instead at what is the redemptive qualities of Dan, and what does that mean for us in 5784? And what it means is we're going to embrace those that are good at bringing beauty into our life. Amen. And we're going to know that we need to be able to discern and be judged, appreciate the judges who know the good eye from the evil eye. Okay? All right, so Dan has an artistic anointing. They did all the engraving and design of metal, wood, and stone. They were weavers and designers of all kinds of fabric. From the tribe of Dan, we got the furnishings of the tabernacle, and we got a lot of the things made that were in Solomon's temple. So they are craftsmen. Okay, so what do we learn? Pray for artistic and creative expression in your worship this month. Did you know creativity is a huge aspect of prosperity? Especially if you are in a field where you have a lot of competition, you're going to need the creativity of the Lord to pull you ahead of your competition. That's something to pray for this month. Pay attention to prophetic words over your life. Dan maybe missed some prophetic words over his life, or he wouldn't have fallen, you know, into the Jeroboam, who put up the Asherah poles kind of thing. Ask God to form a rear guard over past seasons. I only want to take generational blessings with me. Yes. I want a rear guard on generational curses. Amen. And we're going to step on the serpent's head, or we're going to allow the serpent to throw our enemy off their horse. Either way. Amen? Amen. Okay. All right, Capricorn. Well, this is interesting also. What an odd picture, huh? So I've heard a few interpretations. It's like a goat with a fish tail. Well, Jesus is our ultimate sacrifice, our atonement, right? You know the story of the two goats, the sacrificial goat and the escape goat. Those were all very much symbolism and prophetic words for what Christ would do. He would sacrifice himself to atone for the sins and be our atonement. And then the fishtail represents us, the church. So us coming together with Christ, and we have this mighty presence in the earth realm. So it's Arabic for a tail of a goat, Latin for a horned goat or a great horn, commonly represented by a sea goat. You could see why they would think that if it's swimming. It is the brightest star is this Delta Capricorni or Deneb Algedi, the judge who is the sacrifice. So here we see that word judge again. Here we're reminded of the sacrifice of Christ as our light of the world again. So let us tell the tale of two goats, the scapegoat and the sacrificial goat, and here we see the word mercy again. So a part of our testimony this month is the mercies of God and the atonement made. Okay, now this leads us to purifying the blood, because what did Christ do as our sacrificial goat? He shed his blood on the cross. So this is a month when you fast, you are letting your blood and your systems in your body be allowed to be purified. You let the toxins out. Linnell can tell us, she just did a 40-day. I don't think I could do 40 days, Linnell. I don't know how you did that. 3 days is the typical fast. A lot of people do a Daniel fast. Now, interesting note that Chuck Pierce made about this month is to question your sexual sin. Is there anything in culture that maybe is pulling you in the wrong direction in this realm? And it is sexual sin directly is related to the physical operations of your brain and your heart. So this would be a month to evaluate that, get yourself back in alignment, repent, do a fast. But I think we could do this for our culture overall, don't you? I feel like there's a lot of confusion, the male-female confusion. Satan's number one goal is to break down the family unit. So when you're dealing with homosexuality and you're dealing with gender issues, you're breaking down a family unit, and Satan is effectively getting a foothold there. So we can pray for this purification of the blood and that this sexual sin be exposed and redeemed. Amen? Amen. That's what it's all about, repentance and redemption, which leads to victory. Okay, but he pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. The light of the world, Jesus our Messiah. Okay. All right, so what else do we learn from the goat? You know, we have goat nations. You know what that means? That means they don't recognize Christ as their Savior. Now, I went to Sunnybrook Christian Church and heard a speaker from Israel on the conflict in Israel. He's a travel guide in Israel that takes Sunnybrook's team and several other church teams. So obviously he's not able to do tours right now. So he's over here speaking and gathering money to support his family. But he had some really interesting things to say. One thing he said was there is absolutely no way that Hamas and Hezbollah have the manpower and the resources they have without the goat nations supporting them. So we can say it's these terrorist factions if we want, but they feel absolutely surrounded by the goat nations. They also feel abandoned by the Western cultures. They said that Hamas is completely lying to the media, where they say it was a hospital, it was a parking lot. You know, they're playing on that humanitarian. Those are the two things I took from his speech mostly, is I don't want them to feel alone. Amen. Amen. And two, we need to recognize this dichotomy of goat nations versus messianic nations. And be praying for this to be exposed and revealed. It's got to be God's plan. I'm sure we squish it and get in the way, but we can add our alignment. Okay. We will see the goat nations take a wrong turn this month. I think we're already seeing that. Anytime a country has oppression of women, that is a good indication that they are a goat nation, if they don't appreciate women. We want to watch your alignments this month. Well, this can be as easily as, you know, maybe even your boss. You need to be praying for them, right? And we want to leap away from the evil eye, just like a goat would. Leap away. Move away. Go. Okay. All right, so let's wrap it all up. Now, do you see what number's on this door? How fitting, right? 10? I thought that was fun. Okay. All right, we are in the year of the door. This is the door of promise. We want to go through the right doors. We want to be declaring and decreeing the life and the beauty of Christ in our testimony. And as we get face to face with him, we can get strengthened and encouraged. We want to walk on the right path, and we want to find creativity on that path. But in this month of Tevet, in the year of the door, we're going to be looking for new expressions of creativity and worship. We're going to choose to see through our good eye. We're going to establish a rear guard. We're going to share our testimony. And we're going to look to Jesus as the judge and the sacrifice and let our light shine. Amen. Amen. That's Tevet. Okay. Selena or Gail? Oh, I took your picture down, didn't I? Yeah. Can we put it back up there? Can try.
You got really good eyes right here.
That's
Do you want me to use a microphone?
There you go.
Okay. No, I don't have to use a microphone. Actually, I don't mind. But anyway, so this is called The Battle, is what this one is called. And I was sitting back there listening to Arista and going, Lord, is this still applicable? He grows, you know, he grows things so much. And so I believe it is. I also believe that some of you out there may have new pictures for Tevet and maybe new pictures for all the months. So if you are a creative, if you are in those last 3 months, if you are not, you'd be surprised what he does with you. But just be spending some time with the Lord. Ask him for some things. Let's get some more layers of what these months are. So I'm going to invite you, and I'm going to activate that in you in the name of Jesus. You're welcome. Just saying. I know what comes with that. Okay, so this is the battle. And there's some very neat things about this picture. Because there are just some times when you know that the Lord did the picture and not you. And so it's titled The Battle. And the words he gave me were, it was the battle between good and evil, those two eyes, is age old, from the time of the fall of man and probably before. At that moment, humans were open to the knowledge of good and evil. The trouble has become determining which is which. The enemy of our souls is a master at disguising lies as truth. In fact, the enemy cannot create anything. He is not God, nor was he created in the image of God, and therefore cannot create. Knowing this, the enemy takes that which is truth and perverts it, creating a false truth. The difficult part at times is that we inherently recognize the strand of truth but have difficulty untwisting the false from it. This is a primary battlefield of the enemy, our hearts, our souls, and our minds. In this picture, the bright white portal on the left represents truth. Truth, that which comes from God. This is the portal of Holy Spirit from which we gain true revelation and knowledge. The amber portal on the right represents false truth. False truth, those truths which the enemy takes and perverts. This is the portal from which false revelations, knowledge, and mindsets come. And the Lord is having me remind you that false truth does not always appear as darkness. It appears as light. It's just a false light. But that's what puts us off a lot of times, is it's still light. And so we're tempted to take it and walk in it. But we have to get to the point where our perception and our discernment is so that we can tell the difference between the truth and the false truth. Mm-hmm. So the world at the bottom represents that this is a global battle. Mm-hmm. The battle for our hearts, our souls, and our minds is universal. It is the playing field of the enemy. The enemy is no respecter of persons. He will trap all of us in his false truths whenever given the opportunity. And the thing I got on this, as Arista was teaching, is yes, this is global. This is huge. This is large. This is all-encompassing. But if you notice, she also taught that we have a miniature, we have a world inside of us. So this picture is global, and it is within us. This is the battle in us. The beam of light coming from the earth represents the battle, the clash between good and evil. We are the church, and we are more than conquerors in Jesus, which means we conquer and go beyond. We take on the battle, fighting for truth in our hearts, souls, and minds. And the thing today, just today, that the Lord showed me here, anytime you see an image represented of the clash of good and evil, it's always this bing, right? So what comes out of a clash? Light. So don't be afraid of the clash, because what comes out of the clash will always be light. Because the victory is already won. It's already happened. It already is. And so when that clash happens, we can just be certain that that victory and that light is there, and it's ours for the taking. Okay? Ephesians 6:12, for our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Amen.
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 Good job.
Oh, nope, I'm not done. Sorry. There's one thing I always like to point out, because there's always different people here. What is so cool about this picture, okay? So when I created this, you can tell the portals are just the same, right? I just flipped them and then Kevin created the different color because I didn't know how. When I flipped these images, in between them, what appeared was the goat.
Yeah, I see the goat.
Do you see it?
Yeah.
I did not put that there. Okay, when I flipped the images, there it was. The even cooler part about that is if you look at the very top middle, there's another goat.
Yeah.
It's the two goats. It's the scapegoat and the sacrificial goat.
Wow.
So I would take note of that because I didn't do that. Okay. So I look at this every year and I'm like, that is so cool. All right. So those are just some things I wanted to point out is when you create as a creator, you just leave the space. It's not up to you. It's not about perfection. It's not about pulling all the things into all the right places. It's about sitting in the heart frame with God. That's what happens. There you go.
It's hard to follow after her. So in the Tibet, not only is the color turquoise, but it is sapphire. That's why we have the royal sapphire as opposed to turquoise today. But that's one, the two colors. Also, ayan is not only the eye, it also represents spring, which is what I heard and was speaking out to me. It was the springs of living water, time for a new life to flow. And, of course, we know Dan is a tribe that's about judge, growing, and being mature. And the song that I heard was Spring Up a Well. So you spring up a well and make me whole. Spring up, oh well, and give me that life abundantly. I've got a river of life flowing out of me that opens prison doors and sets the captives free. So we have that river of life flowing in us, and it springs up to come out and to do what God's called us to do. So we need to tap all into our gifts. And spring up, oh well, and make us whole. And then the scripture verse I chose was Song of Songs 4:15. A well of living water spring up from in you like a brook flowing into my heart. And then the cloth here has the hammer for Dan as the judge.
Lori asked me if I would lead this morning, and so I began seeking the Father what He wanted to say this morning. And what I felt like He was saying this morning was, this didn't begin at the cross. Okay? This began in the garden. When the Creator of all things looked around at His creation, He said, something's missing. Something's missing. He wanted, desired to be able to have a family, to walk and to talk and to fellowship and to love someone who could love Him back. And the only way they were able to love Him truly was by giving them the ability to not love Him. And so when we as humanity didn't love Him, He made a way. And the light of the world, the light of heaven, stepped into the darkness of the world and made a way. Shedding His blood because there is no forgiveness of sin without the shedding of blood. And so we thank You. Thank You, Father, that You wanted a family and desired to walk in fellowship and covenant with us. And so You made a way, and we thank You, Jesus, for dying, shedding Your blood so that we could, because we couldn't make the way. We couldn't make it happen. So take this now in remembrance of that blood that was shed for us. And then as we take the bread, we remember that the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And that flesh was unbroken, pierced and bruised, because the One who had no sin took upon Himself the punishment for our sin. We also remember the bread of covenant, because we are a family. When we break bread together, and because of the sacrifice that Jesus made, we can love each other the same way that God desires to love and walk with us. And we thank You, Lord, that we have that ability to walk in covenant with one another, to truly love one another, and that is Your desire. As much as You desire to love us and to be loved by us, You desire for us to love one another. And so we thank You, Lord, for making a way. We take this now in remembrance of You.
Praise Him with the shofar. Praise Him.
Strength and rest and light from the sound of the shofar.